On this episode, tick, tick, ska boom. Throw me up, pool shark, because this gun's for hire as we dig on the ska killers, Toasters USA, on Checkered Past, the Ska'd cast. What up, checkerheads? Welcome to Checkered Past, the Ska'd cast with Celine and Rob. The show where, you toasting to me? There's nobody here, so you must be toasting to me. And, hey, I'm skanking here. Explore the history and impact of a different band each episode and hope to bring in new fans along the way. I'm Rob, and this is my sister and co-host, Celine.
Hey, I'm toasting here. Hey, I'm hosting here.
Oh, that's pretty good. I'm hosting here.
Is that offensive? Is that an offensive accent?
No.
No.
I didn't find it offensive. I mean, am I the most important person to answer that question? You know what? We haven't done this in a minute, so why don't we pick it up where we left off? Damn. You know, this is like our first like numbered episode in like 2 months.
That's wild.
The last one we did was. But anyway, what's new with you, sister?
It's a hunter's full moon today. Mm-hmm. The veil is thin. Mm-hmm.
And that means what for the uninitiated? Pretend like I don't know what you're talking about because I do.
It just means like things are kind of intense. It's a full moon in Aries, so it's a fire sign, so things could be anything kind of bumbling under the surface, like typically will come out at this time. Anything to do with relationships, if there's anything anything that you're like not confronting in a relationship may come out during this time.
Got it. Mm-hmm. So stay away from your loved ones.
Yeah, that's why Thanksgiving dinner could be a real stressful.
I'm glad we're playing Mahjong.
Oh yeah,
Canadian Thanksgiving.
Yeah,
yeah,
which feels weird to celebrate.
It's about the
happy
bounty
colonialism
of the
day, right?
That's what it is. It's not about
ours. Isn't as bad.
No, it's dumb. It was like a, random like government holiday that they just kind of shoehorned at us. It doesn't have any historical significance.
Right. Still, anyways.
Yeah.
But we're doing a fondue and playing legit Mahjong.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's exciting.
I bought a Ricci Mahjong set.
Yeah.
Which is very exciting.
Traditional Thanksgiving festivities.
That's what
a fondue. Can we gaslight people to thinking that's normal?
Well, it's French.
It's the fondue,
If there's anything people know about Canada, it's that we got French people here.
Yeah.
And they eat fondue.
Yeah, play Mahjong.
Yeah, probably have a baguette. And no joke, probably will have
a baguette. Ideally. What kind of a fondue is it if you have no baguette?
I have a fun tale. I have a tale. And I'm going to tell this tale
the
way I told Joey, which is Pulp Fiction style. So currently, one of our vehicles, my old white Kia Rio, died on us.
Oh.
And it was me and my wife and my son had COVID. And so after we finally got some semi-healthy, my wife went into the garage to start the car. Lo and behold, doesn't start. So I get my rudimentary mechanic abilities out to try to boost the car to no avail. And I, instead of thinking that the car cannot be boosted, I just assumed that it was a user error. So I called AMA, which is like AAA in the States, I think. And they came over and they attempted a boost and within seconds told me, nope, boost not the problem. Need to get it towed. So I call again and I'm like, hey, sorry, I just called, but I now need the car towed. And
sheepishly.
Car gets towed. I suggest we should take it to the dealer so they can get to it quicker. But my wife has a preferred mechanic, and so went there, but they of course cannot see it for like 2 weeks. But true to their word, they check in on it 2 weeks later and say, can't fix it. The problem is probably with the computer in the vehicle.
Oh,
so you have to take it to the dealership.
Oh no.
So again, sheepishly, I call AMA. Hey, this is the third time I'm calling you about my car. I need it towed to the first place I said I needed it towed to. They gave me a little bit of a lecture about how they don't tow cars that much. they didn't charge me for it and they picked up the car. The dealership calls me and is like, hey, where's the rest of your key? This is the Pulp Fiction part. We go back several weeks. My wife in her COVID state attempts to fix her key fob.
Okay.
Because it's all falling apart. Joey posted this on Twitter at one point, the broken state of the key fob. my wife had a buffet of screwdrivers in front of her. And I was like, you're going to fix your key? She's like, yeah, that's what I'm going to do. It's like, you know what? If anybody can do it, my wife can do it. She's a very talented person. 3 hours later, I check back in on her and it's in a state. And she said, I think if I work at this anymore, I'm going to wreck it. And so we fast forward back to the present day. And the lady on the phone at the dealership's like, yeah, this is missing the battery. And it looks like somebody was hammering the motherboard with a screwdriver. So
it was just the key?
We think that the key is trying to start the vehicle constantly.
Oh.
And that's why it's not turning over. So you need to get a new one. So this may or may not
just
actually
the key, possibly?
It may or may not be the problem. But this is the tale of woe that is the car that has gone through a series of misfortunes. And my wife, needless to say, is pretty pissed off. And of course, if anybody
at
knows,
who?
Literally like herself,
the
whole situation. She feels terrible about it.
I mean, yeah, obviously.
I will say, to her credit, her hit rate's high. She's a 9 out of 10 in terms of I'm going to try to fix something.
Oh, yeah.
And
she's a very, very handy person.
But this in particular thing has caused a expensive problem and she feels bad about it.
Well, shit happens.
Yeah, absolutely. Anyway, that's where I left off. Fun car story.
Fun
during
for
and
everyone.
Post-COVID. Yeah. Well.
Yeah.
Time to bring in our guest. We are absolutely thrilled to introduce our guest. He is a singer-songwriter whose solo Pre-Cure album is streaming everywhere right now through Ska Punk International. And you can catch him on tour playing keys with Cat Bite. KMoy is here. Hi, Kenny.
Hi. Greetings.
Greetings.
So last time you were on, we went through the motions and we got you to tell us your checkered past, etc. And we talked about Slow Gherkin. I encourage people to go back and listen to that episode. It is a classic, if I am too bold to say. But since then, you've been a road warrior and you've been playing keys on tour for the last few months. And I know that you have tour stories, tour thoughts. And if anybody's listening to our last few episodes, that's all I really have been talking about with guests. So let's hear about your life on the road, Kenny.
Okay. Yeah, let's talk about that. I think I'm going to do this whole thing chronologically because I didn't really have a plan, but tour stories. Okay. I'm going to tell the whole thingy of how I got involved with Cat Bite. It happened through the magic of Twitter. Esteban, back in like April or something, made a post about, hey, Catbite needs a replacement person for a tour that's coming up. I saw this post within 1 minute of it being posted, and I was like, okay, I'm going to respond to this. And I was like, I could do it. I can definitely do it. I'm
do
from
it
New
times.
York.
I was just about to say, I could do
oh
it
my God.
Times.
I was going to say that too. I didn't think anybody would get the Home Star reference.
I could do it nine times.
I didn't. But anyway, so yeah. yeah, they wanted somebody local. I'm like, New York, is that local enough? Whatever. Here's a video of me playing with Tape Girl on the Live and Megawave set. Consider this my audition tape. I could play organ. I could do it. I've been wanting.
And you can.
Yeah, I've been wanting people to you know recognize that fact for some time. So anyway, I responded to this thing, and I was like, oh my God, I'm really going to get it. And then I think like 15 minutes later, a Cat Bite account responded back and said, nah, that's okay. We already got some people who are going to do the thing. It'll be fine. We'll keep you in mind later. And I was like, damn it. And then I got really sad, and I wrote a sad song about how I'm not going on tour with Cat Bite.
That's cute.
Yeah, it's pretty cute. So anyway, I think maybe... a month later, I got a DM from Timothy the Moth Hildebrand of Catbite saying, hey, are you still interested in doing the organ for us? And I said, yes. Yes, I am. I am. What's happening? And he was like, yeah, we got a whole tour with Jeff Rosenstock. And also, you have to go to Canada. And I was like, I will. I'll do it. I'll definitely do it. So anyway, So Jeff Rosenstock, Catbite, let's talk about that. At the end of 2021, I made a list of like my favorite albums from 2021, and the number one was Nice One, and the second place was Ska Dream. So that's me touring with like two of my favorite bands
Yeah.
That, like, in my life. So, you know, I was beyond excited and I was scrambling to renew my passport because it had expired. So anyway, eventually I get all that shit cleared up and we go, we have our first rehearsal because Cat Bite is playing a show in Brooklyn. So I do a little small rehearsal with them and immediately everybody in Cat Bite, they have this sort of personality where it just feels like we've already known each other and everything's already cool. And when I played the set with them, which I had been practicing every day before I met them, it was an immediately, it was such a relief to get to play music with people who know exactly what they're doing, because too many times in my life, my frustration with being in bands is just people don't even know what the fuck is up and they're all fucking up and everybody sucks at everything. And Cat Bite does not suck at everything.
No.
They're really great.
They're very, very good.
So that was awesome. And and then I go over to like Cat Bite's place in Philadelphia right before leaving for the freaking things on the Canada tour, which was only like 3 days long. And I go into Cat Bite's apartment. Well, it's just, you know, Timothy and Britt's apartment where they live in Philadelphia. And John DiDomenici is sitting on the couch playing bass, staring at me in my face. And I'm like, that's the basis for Jeff Rosenstock's band, for people who don't know. I'm like, this is crazy. My life feels very crazy right now. It's a little too much to handle. And then I went and I ate a damn Subway sandwich with them at the freaking bar where Brittany Luna works. And I was like, I'll get me of this veganized sub. And then I started eating it and it sucked ass and I hated it. And I was like, this is awful. I've made a terrible decision in front of Cat Bite. And Cat Bite was like, Kenneth, you'll be fine. Everything is okay. And I'm like, all right. And even Christopher Perez, the drummer, he was talking to me and he was being very warm and open with me. One of the first members of Cat Bite to do that to me. Second one being Esteban, who really vouched for me, actually. Like, he was the one who really vouched for me to like be the person to go on tour with them. And like when I had to meet Cat Bite for the first time in Brooklyn, it was Esteban who introduced me to everybody because I was too terrified to meet these people who I was there to meet. Like, I couldn't do it without his help. So
we love Esteban. You know,
yeah. And that was very, very great of him. And yeah, he's great. Speaking of which, well, not yet. Okay, so Chris, he was like talking to me and saying all this nice shit about me. And he was like, Kenneth, you are too good for people to not know who you are. He was like really impressed that I'd never played with a ska band before, being how easily I could fit in with them. And like, yeah, I've never played with a ska band before, but I fantasized about it for half my whole life. So I know how to do it just based on like playing with an imaginary ska band in my head by myself.
You put your 10,000 hours in already.
Yeah, for sure. You did, yeah. Probably over that.
Yeah.
So that was just very kind. And we left to Canada, and being in Canada was wild. It was just wild for me to even be on tour. Like, and I knew how fortunate I was, because most of the time when people go on tour for the first time, it's not great. I'm going on tour with motherfucking Cat Bite for my first time, and I am loving it. Like, the first gig that we did was kind of shitty because of like some dumb promoters or whatever, but right. The second gig was kind of awesome. And then we did one in Buffalo, New York, and like I had like a dramatic, it wasn't that dramatic, but I was having a nice talk with Britt about, you know, like being sober on the road and stuff for me. Like the rest of them aren't sober, but I wasn't. Like, you know, she was like being nervous if I was like uncomfortable around, you know, how many people are like drinking and doing stuff like that. And I was like, no, everything's okay. And she was like, cool. And like, I was still kind of starstruck a bit, even though like I'd known them for 3 days and been in a van with them for 3 days. I was like, oh my God, the singer from Cat Bite is hugging me. Like, that's how that felt. And so, right. But then when we got to Seattle, it was amazing. In Seattle was the first place that I was with the, you know, the Jeff Rosenstock tour, but I didn't play anywhere in Seattle. I was just with them because you can fly me out to Seattle. You can't really fly me out to Montana, which is Montana is like the most nowhere state in the entire U.S. From my experience of just being there, it felt like nowhere. It was actually amazing. You would look out the window and be like, nothing. Wow, we've seen nothing for 3 hours. We've been driving for 3 hours. There's nothing. And then you get to one town and we're like, whoa, it's a town. Then 2 minutes later, it's like the town is over. It's nothing again for hours.
Fun fact about Montana. It looks exactly like Alberta.
Yeah. That's. I was like, you just described Alberta.
It's literally right south of where we live. So like climately and the
sprawling nothingness
of prairie. Yeah. That's our life.
Yeah, like it was. Part of it was kind of stupid, but then another part of it was actually amazing because, like, the impact of the nothingness filled me with like a kind of sense of novelty and excitement that driving through other areas in the U.S. does not fill me with. Like later, not in June, but later we did like a bit of a tour through the South, just a small one, going with Streetlight Manifesto through like Georgia and Florida. And it's like, this just looks like Connecticut. It just looks like anywhere else in the U.S. It's just fucking highways and chain restaurants. The experience of driving through Montana and North Dakota and seeing all this nothing and all these trees and such was actually pretty amazing. Like, I loved that part of it, even if it was, oh boy, it's been a fucking 10-hour goddamn drive. It was kind of thrilling in some respect. Oh, but right. Anyway, so I know there's so much story because, like, I'm enamored by these stories that I got to live. So being in Seattle with Catbite, we had this Airbnb that I stayed at for 3 days before ever playing a show. And Esteban was playing these shows. And I was like, I was intimidated by him because he's never going to say this about himself, probably, but he's a legend and he's like played on all these people's records and like almost every modern record that you hear in the ska genre in the US, he's on as a keyboard player. And so like I was intimidated by him because I'm like, I have to live up to this guy and he's too good. Every record that you listen to, he knows the perfect part to slot in to the thing. He's just got such a beautiful mind for arrangement and tones on the organ. It's like, I can't match this. And so there was an acoustic, an upright piano in the Airbnb. So we got to play piano a lot. And like he was listening to me play piano and he said, Kenny, you're way better than me. I'm just a cool hang. That's the only reason why people want to hang around me. And I'm like, fuck, that is not true. But it felt very relieving to hear him say that.
But that is nice to hear. It's very validating, regardless if it's not true. You're both extremely talented and equally deserving of opportunities. But it is nice to see your like hero origin story and see you rise to greatness that we knew was always possible.
Thank you very much.
Well so, deserved. Yeah.
The first show that I did play was in Montana, in Great Falls, Montana. And I got to wear this wonderful revealing two-piece there for like the first time on stage that Kayla, who was doing merch with Catbite in Canada, but not on this tour. She lives in Brooklyn. So we went out to like a thrift store to buy me like these different little outfits that I was going to be wearing on tour, which was a great, wonderful experience. I had Britt do my makeup for like the first three shows that we played. And then one time she was like, Kenny, you got to start doing it by yourself. I'm like, okay, fine. So I started doing it by myself. I'm like, I don't know what I'm doing. And she's like, it's okay. The point of makeup is to have fun. It doesn't have to be perfect. I'm like, okay. And so that was a wonderful, beautiful
I want this
experience.
Like makeover montage of like you awesome. Going to the thrift store and like trying on different outfits.
Oh,
and like
yeah.
just looking over at like everyone and they're just shaking their head no or yes. Yeah.
That's very funny. And, yeah. And she actually had a very beautiful eye for stuff that I would like, Kayla. She really did. So
some people just get it. Some people just get it.
Yeah.
And you looked great on tour. The fits they're good fits. Yeah, and a makeup journey, much. it is just trial and error, unfortunately. But there's way more like video, like, you know, if getting into makeup now is like way easier than when I was a kid. There's so much like there's so much information out there.
Yeah.
So just you like, are in you. A good timing.
Thank you. I mean, mostly I've just gotten advice from like people I know in real life, like Britt and Tape Girl, which but yeah. So right. I played the first show in Montana and it was like so freaking cool. And like in Montana, it was a huge venue, but like even somebody like Jeff Rosenstock isn't going to be the biggest draw in like the biggest city in Montana. So like the venue was kind of like open, so I could just like jump around and have the gayest old time watching Jeff Rosenstock play these amazing songs and just like feeling amazing and like listening to songs like, you know, You in Weird Cities and just feeling like I have gone through the hero's journey of this song. Because, you know, like when I was first listening to that song, it was kind of a bit like my life of like always getting high when no one is around and shit like that. And like, you know, I got to be in Weird Cities and shit and tour with Catfight and Jeff Rosenstock. It's amazing. And so that part was cool. And I have to skip a bunch of other stories right now just because I want to get into this wonderful side quest. This wonderful side quest. It's a great side quest. I got to tell you about it. Okay.
There's an orange legendary at the end of it.
Jeff, you know, all the people in Jeff Rosenstock, I would be talking to them sometimes in like the green room and stuff like that. Because, you know, they're very kind people, but I'm like still very nervous, especially around Jeff, because he has this this very big following and very big cult of personality. And when somebody has that kind of thing and has so much like fans that have like a big hero worship around them, I don't want to talk to them because I don't want to give them the impression that I'm that. And I feel like they're very wary around people who might be a little too fanboyish, even if they're like, you know, playing in a band and stuff. I'm very scared of talking to somebody like that because I don't know. I don't know what their experience is with like fans and stuff. And I feel like they might not like that. Sort of like this is skipping ahead, but like we did Streetlight Manifesto and Thomas Kalnoki also, he's way more famously like reclusive and doesn't like do interviews and stuff. And like most of the people in Streetlight Manifesto didn't talk to us in the same gregarious way that the Jeff Rosenstock people did. And I think it's different because we would just be like doing on and off shows with Streetlight instead of like a constant tour with Jeff. But I could see Tom like trying to be social sometimes. And he talked to us sometimes, but he mostly talked to us as a group instead of individual people. And like, I appreciate this anyway, because I can tell this is pretty hard for you to do. So
yeah,
like, I always appreciate anybody's effort that they give towards being social, because I think it's something that you don't necessarily have to do.
You don't owe it to anyone to like entertain them and be on. You can just be like a human and be yourself. And yeah, if you're not an extrovert, it can just be like super draining, especially if you're on tour and you need to like conserve your energy like for performing. I definitely get why people like aren't the most like social and extroverted when they're off stage. Yeah,
for sure. Like that's how I like, you know, I also put myself in their shoes and think how I would feel about that. But anyway, so like I didn't want to talk to them all that much, but it slowly started to be that I did talk to them a lot. Like Mike Huguenor was very nice to me. He told me that I'm an amazing keyboard player. I'm like, oh my God, that's amazing. You know, because he's such an amazing guitar player. Like his level of like precision and proficiency is amazing. And he's still like tries to be perfect on stage himself. Like we were talking about the song No Dream, which is such a beautiful song. And I was like, you know, I noticed that when he plays that song, he just like, he's rocking back and forth while he plays the main jangle riff. And I'm like, are you like in the zone when you do that? Are you like spacing out? And he's like, no, it's not really like that. I am just trying to be as precise as possible because I'm one of the only instruments playing. I have no way to disguise myself. So I want everything to be absolutely perfect. And Jeff is very particular about the kind of guitar tones that happen. And so like, I'm like, wow, you know, so like even really amazing musicians are still, you know, struggling and trying all the time, which is beautiful. But OK, so sorry, getting sidetracked. Sean Dolan. Let's talk about Sean Dolan.
Side quest.
Sure. This talk is about Sean
side
Dolan.
Quest. Side quest.
Yeah.
Sean Dolan, guitarist for the Blue Meanies, right? He is a fan of mine
on Twitter. Yeah.
Yep. He's a fan of mine. Like we first talked because he gave me like a DM out of nowhere. I'm not sure how anybody introduced him to the Precure album, but he like told me that it was like a very amazing experience. He really loved listening to it. And like most music doesn't capture his interest these days, but that one did. And I was like, oh, thank you very much, Sean Dolan. So anyway, Sean lives in Kansas. He lived in one of the cities that we were going to play tour on. So he came to see me, and, you know, we had a bit of a talk outside of the venue for a bit, you know, because it was like post sound check. And then out walks Dan Podhast, who is in Jeff Rosenstock's band. Also very nice guy. Love that guy. And he comes out and is like, hey, Sean, because they hadn't seen each other in 20 years because they were touring together as Blue Meanies and MU330 back in 2002. So they go and catch up, and then I go upstairs and start, you know, getting ready and, you know, doing like makeup and stuff. And this time we had a shared room. Everybody, Namdi, Rosenstock, Catbite, we're all in the same green room upstairs in this attic. And so Jeff is talking to me about, you know, about like, you know, do I like ska a lot? Is that like something that I listened to? Or is this just something that I picked up for tour? Because he was like on the sidelines of the previous show watching me and like watching me use the drawbars. And I was like, oh, yeah, I listen to ska a lot. Like one of my big influences actually when it comes to playing the organ is Slow Gherkin. And he's like, oh my God, I love Slow Gherkin. Slow Gherkin is amazing. And then we had a long conversation about Shed Some Skin. And he's like, yeah, that's like one of those albums where like the lyrics, they mean even more to you as time goes by, which is not very common with like music that you listen to as a teenager. And I was like, oh yeah, I mean, yeah, like, yeah, I feel silence. And he talked about how he feels sort of the same way about the Less Than Jake album, Hella Rock View. And we had this moment where we said the same phrase at the same time, because we both like were gushing over the song Al's War. And he's like, oh my God, Al's War is so amazing. Like the chords and the lyrics and the bridge. And we both said the bridge at the same time. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, whoa, shit. Because the bridge is amazing. The bridge is like the best part of that whole album. It's a pop punk masterpiece, that bridge. And so that was cool. And then upstairs walks Dan Podhast. And he's like, hey, guys, there's a real Blue Meanie here. There's a Blue Meanie downstairs. And he's like, what? Yeah, Sean Dolan. I haven't seen him in like 20 years. He said he's here because of Kenny. He said that like, Kenny makes an album and he really loves it. I didn't even know that Kenny made music. And like, okay. I'm just over in a corner right now, like putting on makeup next to Britt. And then John yells over, hey, Kenny, we're talking about you right now. And I'm like, I know, I can hear it. And John's like, Kenny, we're going to play your record right now. I'm like, oh my God, no, don't do that. And Jeff says, Kenny, don't worry. I wouldn't want anybody to do that to me, so I'm not going to do it to you. I'm like, okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much. So, you know, we played that show, and it was a great show, beautiful show. Jeff hugged Sean Dolan shirtless when Sean came up into the green room, because he was like, oh my God, I love your band so much. Blue Meanies meant so much to me back in high school. He's like, I'm sorry to punish you like this. And I'm like, that's just amazing. To watch some of your heroes be like, oh, I'm sorry to punish you, because you're like, no, I'm the person who punishes you. Like this is not how this goes. So that was cool, and that happened. And then the next gig was in Colorado, and I'd like been hoping to God that none of us would get coronavirus this whole fucking tour, so we wouldn't have to cancel Colorado, because that's where Beth lives, that's where Tape Girl lives. We'd been friends for 2 years and we'd never seen each other in real life. And so we finally did. And it was amazing. It was an absolutely wonderful, it was a beautiful day. I loved it. But even on top of all that, the next, when we played the show, like in the green room, Jeff was yelling at me from across the way saying, Kenny, I heard your fucking album. It fucking rips. You got great songs. And I'm like, oh, okay. Okay. Thank you, Jeff. And, After the whole show, Dan Pias came up to me and he's like, hey, Kenny, I didn't want to, you know, bother you before, but I just want to say I heard your album in the van. And like, it was really great. Like, it's not often these days that I get to hear something that I really love, but I was listening to like, fuck yeah, Kenny in the car. It was great. And also, I really love that single that you did. I was like, Beth Has Secrets? And he's like, yeah. And I'm like, oh my God. Dan, I should tell you, I wrote that song. Like, the way that I wrote the song was like by doing like a joke impression of your voice and your singing style. So like, I'd be thinking about showing you this song and hoping that you would eventually hear it. And he's like, wow, I mean, I'm not sure if that's why I liked it, but I really liked it. And it was like, oh, God, that's amazing. And like, I had this nice hero's journey type talk with, I don't know why I keep saying fucking hero's journey.
I said your hero's origin yeah. story. I put it yeah. in your head and it's canon.
And Dan was just, you know, talking to me and I was like, yeah, I told him I'm working on music again. I'm not doing an album of original material for a while because like it took so long to come up with those songs. I'm just like working on a cover album until more songs come to me. And he said, yeah, I mean, like, you know, life and touring, I feel like it's all part of the process. Like your brain just needs to be loaded with experiences and information before you can write something again, you know? But like, I feel like if your heart is in the right place and you really genuinely believe in what you're doing, it's going to find the right audience, you know, without you even having to try. I'm like, oh, thank you. Thank you, Dan Podast. I keep calling people like by their full name because yeah. I still like view them that way. And like,
yeah, I like
now,
that you're like, Brittany, the lead singer of Catbite. Like, not, yeah. not Brit, not.
yeah, no.
Thank like, you, Brittany, the lead singer of Catbite. No.
I totally call everybody that. I'm like, even in the band, if I'm talking to people, I'm like, hey, Benjamin Perry, do you want me to get in first? And, you know, shit like that. That's how I talk to people.
That's so, yeah, good. It's nice.
The Jeff Rosenstock tour was absolutely amazing. And being like with Streetlight Manifesto, it just feels like we played even bigger venues with them. And I get all these people like coming up to me after the shows, like even more people than in the Jeff Rosenstock shows were getting like being like, hey, I want to take a picture with all you people in Catbite, and I want to do this, and I want to do that. And it only one show did it get overwhelming, but that's because I was standing in front of like this bar where all these bartenders were trying to get in and out, and it was like a huge sensory overload. But yeah, it's great. It's wonderful. I have all these, I don't know. Yeah, like sometimes, you know, meeting fans, maybe people think it's annoying, but sometimes it's actually amazing. I don't know. Like I met this little kid they might have been like 13, but you know,
that's a tiny little like, baby child.
Yeah, yeah. Who was like, you know, crying upon meeting me. And Chris was like, Kenny, there's Aww. A child who specifically wants to meet you. And I'm like, okay. And you know, and I think it's, I don't know. It's,
that's sweet.
It's fun. Yeah. It's a gay old time. And I love Catbite so much. I love every single person in Catbite individually. I'm endlessly fascinated by them as people, and I'm just grateful that they let me be a part of their life. And yeah, that's all.
And I think I'm sure they're grateful to have you as well.
It's been
you add to the team.
We all love to see all this wonderful things happening to you. Like, we got to know you back when we first started, when you were commenting on our 5 Hour and Frenzy episodes, and we were talking a little bit there. And then, you know, we were lucky enough to keep talking to you and become friends online. And then the album came out, and Chris hooked us up to get you on the podcast. And then, you know,
is that how
then,
it worked?
Yeah.
Chris?
Yeah, Chris. Mm. Chris was like, hey, you know, Kenny's putting out his album on my album or on my
a
label.
Real matchmaker.
And he only wants to go on your podcast. And I was like, damn, that sounds awesome. So I was like, yeah, for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's true. Because I just, whatever. I was doing Cool Chris, and it's like, this is already the album deep dive. I don't want to talk about my album. I just want to, like, have a fun goof off session and like talk about Slow Gherkin. That was way more interesting to me after already doing an in-depth dive thing. I didn't feel like doing that again. Yeah,
we're the good time fuck around podcast.
The fun goof off yeah. session.
Yeah,
come for a fun goof off session.
And so today we're talking toasters. Whoa. We're gonna pivot over there. So
Golden
me and you
Brown.
Talk about toasters a lot.
That's true.
So why the toasters? Like, why would this be like your ideal band to talk about? And yeah, why toasters?
Okay, so I'm gonna give two reasons. Like, reason number one is they're very influential on me, on my own music. Like, I mentioned how I told Jeff like Slow Gherkin was a big influence on how I play organ in ska. Like, it's that's the top influence, and the Toasters is also the top influence, particularly their 90s albums, like the organ playing on those, very transformative. And when it came to making the Precure album, I was like trying to study how do you play like drums in a third wave style, and I would like listen to the Selector and the Toasters for that, and how you do bass. I would listen to the Toasters a lot for how do you make a good ska bass line, because I am so enamored with Matt Mollis' bass lines, particularly, who joined the Toasters in, I think he might have joined them in New York Fever or This Gun for Hire, I'm not sure. But like,
I believe it's Gun for Hire, but yeah.
Yeah, he's an absolutely amazing bassist. So there's that. And here's the other reason. I'm going to give this. This is like a kind of surprising fact. It's a bit surprising. So I'm going to relay all the first ska albums that I got just to like give some context. The first ska albums that I got with an Amazon purchase like back in late 2003 was 3-5 Iron Frenzy albums, them being Quantity is Job 1, our newest album ever, and The End is Near / Here. And then I got like Scottolite's collection. I got a Fishbone 101. I got the Specials, you know, self-titled. I got Madness One Step Beyond. And then I got two albums by the Toasters, Hard Band for Dead and New York Fever. No, sorry, not New York Fever, Ska Boom. And Ska Boom was the last record to come in. And of all these classic albums, the one that I ended up enjoying most at the time was Ska Boom. Like, I like all these. This one is my favorite. We can talk about why later, but I was really enamored with that album.
And it was the first one I had heard as well. And I kind of, yeah, I when I started getting into ska in the late 1990s, early 2000s, I did a... I think I progressed through their records, like from Ska Boom up to the current day. And so I kept like, so I always went back to Ska Boom because that was the first one I had listened to. And I have nothing but like re-listening to it, nothing but fond memories of just like hanging out in my parents' house and just listening to Toasters. I was lucky enough to see them one time. And I've talked about the story on the podcast, so I won't talk about it again because it was traumatizing. But Celine, Toasters?
Okay, so I... okay, I like was... I've only had like... I've only been into singles. I've never really right. like gotten into the Toasters. And there's a lot of songs that like... I didn't know were Toasters. There's a lot of songs that I thought were Toasters that weren't. Like, there's just been a lot of revelations listening through it. Yeah. Wasn't what I thought it was. Not in a bad way. It just wasn't. There's a lot of assumptions I had.
I think the Toasters are analogous to what we call like Canadian ska.
I like know nothing very, about very like close. The history and or like what age and like year anything came out. Like I actually know like literally nothing.
And I totally asked
and
Celine
I don't
to do
want
that.
To hear a single word about it. Play a song.
Celine just teed up the best segue in the world and then just stole it out from under me.
Yeah, I know you just look too happy. I had to take it away.
It's time to take the time scosheen back to 1980 to explore the checkered past of the Toasters. So a lot of my favorite places to get this from, AllMusic, Wikipedia, Discogs, spent a lot of time 80s. On there because they have so many musicians.
That's not what I thought.
And VW Music did an interview with Bucket that has a lot of really good stuff from their early years. So I pulled a lot of quotes.
There
and
was good info
trivia
for the Toasters.
From there. Yeah.
Sometimes there's not for bands.
Oh, yeah.
I like to know.
Oh,
sometimes there's like
it's not Popes of Chili Town.
Yeah, this is like, there's crumbs.
Where I have to like really pick away at stuff.
So this was like a rich history.
There is a rich tapestry of the Toasters. It's not all out in the open, but you get a lot
a
of
ska
stuff.
Quilt.
The ska quilt, which is just black and white checkers, yeah. Let's be honest. So we take the time scotching back to New York City, 1980, where Robert Bucket Hingley just immigrated from his merry old England, where he left behind the explosive two-tone scene that he loved and held dear. Surprised to find that none of his favorite bands were even heard about in the US, especially on the East Coast, he spent his days managing the comic book shop Forbidden Planet, which
That's
was a
fun.
UK-based chain that was making inroads in the US. Things changed for Buck when The Beat finally hit the US and played the Roseland Ballroom in New York, and it was clear that ska had a chance. So, about those early years, here's a good quote from Bucket. So it's a little lengthy, so bear with me. Yes, it's true. I started work for Forbidden Planet in London at the back end of 78, having graduated from York University with a linguistics degree in 77. I spent a year working with my friend who was renovating row houses before moving back south, having been offered the FP job by another university pal who's already working there. I ran their science fiction department, amongst other things, and was also in charge of buying collections of comics, toys, books, and collectibles. One of my clients was Joe Jackson, for whom I procured EC and Silver Age DC books. I became friendly with him, and coincidentally, he moved to New York City at the same time I did in 1980 when I was asked by Forbidden Planet to go and open the New York branch, help them with all their ordering, buying, mail order systems. So I landed in Manhattan in May 1980 in the cauldron of the Lower East Side, which at the time was rich in artists, musicians, and other creative types. On any given day, we would run into Johnny Ramone, Rick Okacek.
Any given day?
Glenn Danzig.
New York.
And Steve Stevens of Billy Idol. Yeah.
New York.
In the shop, chewing the fat. Robin Williams used to come in and buy Japanese robots and throw impromptu performances in the basement.
That place was personal really information that shouldn't be disclosed.
Meanwhile, my local, I think he just likes to like just drop names.
Yeah. I was like, so I didn't want to know that. That makes me feel
drop
weird.
Drop names.
Oh, you didn't know my local. About Robin the Williams Japanese loved anime. He yeah. was really,
really?
Yes.
He was a weeb? Who do you think Robin Williams' waifu is? I'm trying to think of like the timing.
In 1980.
Who's Robin Williams fapping to in the 80s?
Oh my
during
god.
Anime?
Okay. I don't know if it went that deep.
Yeah.
It always goes that deep.
Excuse you.
Sorry.
I don't want to be
anyways,
sandwiched
here.
I'm done. How's Chainsaw?
It's a I really love. Good.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
People are horny for Makima.
Won't sit here getting all this aggression.
Okay, I'm projecting. I see.
That place was really alive. Meanwhile, my local pub was the Park Inn Tavern on Avenue A, and patrons there included Wayne Kramer of the MC5 and Richard Hell of Avoidoids. The scene was cracking. So, Buck quickly put together a lineup for a new band made up of various people he knew and no shortage of fellow employees from his comic book store, his roommates, and bar patrons. He had to essentially teach everybody how to play ska, which was incredibly difficult. By 1981, it was solidified under the name Not Bob Marley, and they got their first... yeah, it's a good one, right, Joey? They got their first gig opening up for a new DC hardcore band that was making waves at the time, Bad Brains. This was pre-first Bad Brains record. They rolled through New York like Ska'd Dynamite, waiting for their fuse, and by 1983, cobbled together their first single titled Beat Up. They also began striking up a stronger friendship with Joe Jackson, who was enthusiastic enough about their material that he produced their first EP, Recriminations, released in 1985, which was simultaneous with another ska EP that came out at that time on the West Coast.
Which one?
I know.
Which one? Why are you being weird about it?
Do you know which one, Celine? Can you take
I don't.
Okay.
Kenny?
It's Fishbone. Fishbone EP.
Oh, that's why you were being like that. I see that. I was like, why are you being like that? I see.
He strokes his chin.
Mid.
To Toasters fans, the EP is a strange microcosm with no brass, female-male duets, and a lot of new wave with the melodica, Maka Gang Rise Up, by Joe Jackson. No surprise at the time, though, that in spite of the band's local fervor, New York fever, I guess, in the underground, major labels expressed intense skepticism at ska, making any headwinds in the U.S. Seen only as a novelty, ska? Buck made it a point to increase ska's legitimacy, so he decided to go full DIY, formed his own label, Moon. This is what Buck said about that. The demo had been produced by our buddy Rich Thomas of the Lower East Side Rockers, the preeminent rockabilly act in the city at the time.
Boo.
To no avail.
Why boo? You love that shit.
Oh, slam! Oh, drag me to hell, Kenny. Drag me to...
Damn, just saw you. Just saw you from across the way.
What were you saying?
One A&R rep told us that we'd never get anywhere playing that circus music. And even Bob Criscow of Village Voice said that he would never review our release because we were just a bar band. That sounds right. So there was no other choice than to release our first single ourselves on the Ice Bar label, later to become Moon. We felt that it was a mistake to wait and keep shopping the band around instead of taking advantage of all the interest we're getting on college radio, mom and pop record stores, and regional promoters, as well as club owners. I could tell there was something there, even if the record label execs didn't. The next step was, of course, to record a full length and put the Toasters' best foot forward. At this time, much like their two-tone bands that Bucket idolized, they didn't have a full-time horn section, but for what Bucket was hoping to accomplish, that needed to change, and was truly the lit fuse for their dynamite. The lineup was massive. I mean, I won't do guess that horn, but can you guess
I'll
how many,
guess some horns.
Can you guess how many members?
Horns.
Oh yeah, we'll bring
you said
back,
it was a different, you said it was a different lineup.
First, let's talk about how many members of the Toasters
the
there were at this time.
Okay.
Can you guess?
Okay, well, there's got to be a singer.
I asked for a number and now you're just
I'm
like listening.
Counting.
Okay. Okay, there's a singer.
And there's a bass player.
Yeah.
And there's an
oh yeah, there's a bass
organ player.
Yes.
And there's at least one guitar.
Yep.
And a drum player.
Sure.
So we're already at five.
Okay.
I'd say three horns. I'd say a good 8 to 9 to 10 to 11?
11.
What? That's wild.
There are 11 members of the Toasters at this time. And you
dedicated
said
dedicated
melodica?
Is that what
there's
it is?
A toaster and there's three singers? What do you mean?
Three.
What are they doing?
There are three singers.
That's my
Toasters.
Dream is to be like the
there's
third
Bucket
one.
And
like,
then the
I
Unity
wanna,
2, which are the Toasters.
I would love to just be like, I'm just a kind of backup singer sometimes. Yeah. What a great gig.
And Bucket plays the guitar.
Oh, but what if you're useless?
So that other member?
Otherwise.
That one other member?
What did they do?
They play a shitload of percussion.
Yeah, see, that's the dream. They're living the dream. That's who I want to be.
Yeah,
I want to bring out the slide whistle.
Four horn players. Can you guess the horn?
Okay, let's go for it.
Okay, go for it.
Oh my God.
Trumpet?
Nope.
There's...
I gave the number.
Trombone?
Yeah.
Sax? Sax?
Sax, yeah.
Trombone?
No.
Yeah, I said trumpet.
Not a trumpet.
And not another sax?
Not another sax.
What do you mean? Those are all the horns.
It's a cornet.
A French horn?
A cornet.
A cornet?
Aw, you're cheating. Cornet's
what
like
is
a,
that?
Cornet's
what
basically,
is
basically
it's
a
basically
trumpet.
A trumpet.
Okay. He's just being an asshole. Is it just a little trumpet?
It's the little like marching band trumpet.
Mm. Yeah. I forget. Yeah. They're like stacked in terms of brightness. Trumpet is the middle one. And then on the opposite end, there's flugelhorn and cornet. I forget which one's brighter
and
which one's darker.
That's some Whoville shit that doesn't actually exist. Yeah, is the cornet know. Higher? I feel like if it's littler, it would be like beep, 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 beep.
It is exactly
like did that sound exactly like a horn?
Yeah,
with your,
it did to me.
Advanced musical ear.
Yeah. No, that was a horn. No, it wasn't. It was not a horn. I'm not going to lie to the people.
And of course, much like Buck's beloved Beat, they were a mixed race group and they prided themselves on that throughout their entire career.
And they're pretty skinheady as a mixed race group.
Yeah, legit.
Like they're like a super like oi skinhead ska band. Correct, Amundo?
I'd say we'll get into it.
Or like that, say that was... It's more of the oi working class.
Yeah, there's a little bit of that, but then...
Oi.
Well, yep. Yeah.
Oi.
Yeah, that one specifically, for sure.
Come on, boys, to the east side,
boy. Don't give it away.
It's just funny. It's New York, but he's so British. Anyway, keep going.
So, time for a visual thing. Uh-oh. Fuse meets dynamite and ska-boom.
Woo!
The vinyl.
I do have the vinyl. Yes.
Rob's displaying the.
This
vinyl.
Is the German version. I don't know why that's the one I have. That is basically the. It's the track list of Pool Shark, but with Ska Boom skin on top of it.
That's wild.
It's very weird. I don't understand. But I own it. I think I got it through Jump Up. Back in the when they had the record thing, and I also got at the time the reissue of Two Tone Army. And which was a hard band for dead and Dub 56 prized possessions of mine.
Fun.
So Ska Boom was the Toasters' debut released on Celluloid Records in 1987. The album was a true ode to two tone with a larger focus on horn lines, more of a rough and tumble production style, as well as Bucket's simple, very New York centric lyrics. It also melded a lot of R&B, rockabilly, a little bit of jazz, a little bit of calypso. And this it's so confusing to find what the track lists are. The original release had 11 songs on it, but it was also called Pool Shark in the UK with 15 songs. And the CD reissue has 19 songs on it. But that's the one that most people are probably familiar with because it has the EP tagged on to the end. And now when they reissue the vinyl, they will mix and match which version comes out. It is very strange and it's hard to keep track of. But that is Ska Boom. And it is probably one of the most influential albums in the ska genre, especially in East Coast ska and American ska music. So you know what? Celine kind of gave it away. So before we get into our discussion, why don't we start with one of their most iconic songs, number two, East Side Beat.
It's good. Woo! Oi. You're not British, why are you saying oi?
He is British. Bucket is also very, very British for a New York guy.
For a New York
the girl? Most British New York guy on the planet. The bass playing is something else.
Oh, it definitely is.
Very spooky.
This is like
it is spooky. It's spooky.
It's very this sounds very UK ska to me.
Definitely.
More than Canadian ska, whereas their later stuff is like I can't do more.
I'd say so. Maybe that'd be more like the 90s.
Yeah, I'm thinking because I resonate more with this stuff.
Oh yeah.
Not to tip my hat.
Iconic. Boy. Literally like their first single.
Yeah, it's very good.
It appears on this and the next two albums in various forms.
Like, you heard that song? You guys like that song? You like to say oi with us? Yeah, you guys
wanna... Literally, they play that song wherever possible.
Of course.
It is.
And I'd be pissed if they didn't play it.
Yeah. 100% they played it when I saw them. 100% they did. And that everyone's playing up the world.
That song is an eternal banger, and I know... I think it was Cool Chris's introduction to ska was hearing one of the live versions of this. I can't remember which album it was. Could have been the one on This Gun for Hire, or maybe it was the one on Dub 56. I'm not sure, but he heard a live version of East Side Beat, I think, as his first ska song. That made him go, whoa, holy fuck. That was Cool Chris, origin story right there.
And that live one that shows up later, I like that it like starts real like kind of like different, and then it just picks up in the middle of it just...
I forgot that. I was like, oh, yeah, well, what was my... And it was just Specials a little bit from Dance Dance Revolution. But same thing. I was like, what is this? This is fun. What do we get to say, bitch?
Yeah.
We get to? Yeah.
This album's a monster. Like, the full version with the 19 songs is a lot to get through. And like half, I feel like maybe a third to a half of the songs get re-recorded later on other albums. Yeah. And so it's interesting to hear these versions because... Like, I don't know how it's a maximalist effort, I guess the best way to put it. Ska Boom is maximalist.
You think?
Oh, there's...
It's all of it?
There's so much happening all the time. The organ and piano playing is crazy. There's so much percussion.
So, sorry, this was Moon Records?
This was Celluloid.
No, this is Celluloid. When did Moon Records happen?
He started Moon Records to put out his EP.
Oh, his EP.
Yeah. But has not put out a full Toasters record yet. This was on Celluloid, which we'll talk about later.
Okay.
And
but Kenny, talk to me about Ska Boom.
Okay. Yeah, I'm just like standing over here just being like, you know, so hyped to say anything. Okay. So, right. Yeah. The 19 tracks, when you listen to it, you can definitely tell where the other parts of it are. I think you neglected to mention the Naked City EP, which is also a part of this thing. Is that true? I think Naked City was like a vinyl part. It's from the track Ideal Man up through Naked City. It's a whole total different recording. Like
fact-checking.
Ska Boom starts from like Talk Is Cheap up through So Long Buck. Then it's Ideal Man through Naked City. And then it's like, what's the first one? Recriminations up through Radiation Skank. Those are all like three different discs, I think. Three different vinyl discs that were put on the CD version.
Oh, and it's, I think that the Naked City stuff was the extra tracks that appeared on Pool Shark.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
That's
See,
me being
it's
a
so
little
freaking
confusing.
I don't get it. The 19 track one, that's the one to listen to because you get them all. You get all the songs.
I did get confused when listening. I kind of just like kept playing it at work and I'm like, I'm sure I'm listening to most of the songs I was supposed to listen to.
Yeah, yeah.
So anyway.
Sublime was the same way, like just so many re-releases. But yeah, anyways.
True. Yeah. Anyway, I love this album. And it is funny that it is a maximalist effort because even though it's maximalist, it doesn't have the big budget that makes it feel that way sometimes. It just feels very, you know, it feels kind of like a little cheap and low fidelity. But there's part of it that really works for me. Like when I hear a song like Weekend in LA or Talk is Cheap, it kind of feels like, you know, a bunch of guys in New York City in the 80s, like playing something on a street corner in the summertime. Like that's how it feels to me. It just feels that kind of dirty and like, I love it. And it honestly didn't even occur to me until this year or not this year, but a couple of years ago that they re-recorded the songs maybe because the production value was so low at first. I didn't even realize that. I was just thinking, oh, they want to re-record these songs because they're really good songs and they just feel like doing it again. Like I wasn't ever thinking maybe Bucket was dissatisfied with the original production of Talk is Cheap or Recriminations or Weekend in LA. I'm like, oh no, they're just really great songs and they want to record them again. So I like these lo-fi, not lo-fi, but I like these kind of cruddy sounding versions sometimes more than the re-recorded one. Like
I like the kind of dirtier, grungier. I like the production on this album.
The songs too that you mentioned, like Weekend in LA and Talk is Cheap and
Weekend in LA,
Razor Cut and those types of songs, they're also the less goofy songs on there. I find that they're goofier tracks like Shocker or Manipulator,
right?
Maybe are the ones that don't hold up as much. And
oh, for sure.
It's funny because there's nobody that played that way, but Ska that way.
And that's,
I don't know how to even describe
it
because of how kind of silly they sounded. And like, there's nobody nowadays that's like, you know what, we got to bring back Shocker era toasters with
You're
the crazy
so true.
Bass lines. Yeah.
Nobody does that. And there's like, I'm thinking to myself, I should do something like that, like not exactly like that, but I do sort of lament how this era of the toasters doesn't have as much influence on modern day stuff because like as the toasters went on, I feel like the third wave sound that they were, pioneering on the East Coast started to get like more streamlined and more focused and more beat focused. And here it's a lot more experimental and messy. Like he had to teach people initially how to even play ska. So like, the bass lines here, they're ska-ish, but they sound like a lot more busy and new wave than they would even on like the next album, Thrill Me Up.
Let's play Now or Never because that was a request from
you. Oh, fuck, I love that one.
Yeah, and we'll talk about busy bass lines.
Sure.
Oh, I came in on the solo because it was
I love the guitar solo. Yeah.
They definitely, the toasters, rockabilly people love the toasters. That is a straight through line. Yeah. Like the vibes.
Yeah. It's also like heavy R&B. Like,
yeah. Like Robert Christgau really saying, yeah. Oh, they're a bar band. They feel a bit bar bandish because they play bar band music, kind of. Like,
you can go dance to the toasters. You could go, you could be like, I'm going to go dancing. And you know that if you go to a toaster show, you can dance the whole time.
Mm-hmm. I should mention, Let's let this breathe a little bit because I want to listen to the crazy bass.
There it is. It's just popping. Bass popping away.
I've never heard so much slap bass that sounded less funky. Like,
yeah. It's like a rubbery slap bass. It's not like a Norwood kind of slap bass.
Well, a gumby bass?
It's like an arpeggio. Like it's almost like disco, but
yeah,
like not quite like. Almost missing it
because you're right, it's like that era new wave was kind of like inspired a bit by disco, so there is like that octave
there's definitely
you know,
like a new wave vibe
going on with the bass line. I also want to mention how on this album and the next album too, their original organ player wasn't doing what a lot of organ players in the two-tone era and even the third wave era would end up doing a lot, which is playing the skank, you know, just playing the shit, 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 or the This guy was like coming up with like counter melodies and stuff that would like answer the horn lines. And I feel like that's really cool. In some ways, it doesn't work beautifully, but I love the idea of it. And that's kind of something that I'd like to see incorporated a lot more. Yeah.
It's back to that maximalist type of style where it's like almost every instrument needs to hear itself. The bongo-ness of this album is insane. Like the amount of bongo, like not.
Do you know what bongos do?
What?
Give a tiki vibe.
Oh, there is a tiki vibe.
It gives a tiki bar vibe.
But that, yeah.
Tiki bar.
You know
tiki
who,
bar.
You know who really loved this album is Forget the World era Hippos.
Mm.
With the crazy slap basses and all the bongo. Like that was like all over their stuff. They're nerdier and a little bit more modern, but this style really, I think, implied them. Maybe I'm off, but
Now that's something I want to check out because I've listened to Heads Are Gonna Roll, but I haven't listened to that album.
Oh yeah, see, I'm a Forget the World stan because that was the first one I bought. That was one of my first albums I ever bought, and so I love it.
Your
Heads Are Gonna Roll is good, but yeah. Forget the World, soft piece. Ooh, a little hole in my heart where I feel with that one.
Small little tribute. Just want to give a small little tribute to the first EP, Recriminations EP. The stuff I really admire about that. I really admire the female male vocals going back and forth in that thing, and like the new wave vibe.
I think it's cool.
I love the guitar solo on Razor Cut. It's a really nice guitar solo. Great. I that EP to me kind of underappreciated. I like it as dingy as it is. I really like it.
Yeah, I liked it too. I mean, the version of Razor Cut on Dub 56 is a little bit better, but like Run Rudy Run is a great song.
Like Razor Blade Culture was big.
Razor Blade Culture was
big. Yeah, people were really into like
yeah.
People Shovel? Were really there into razor blades. I like when I worked at the Rockabilly store, there was like a lot of like, and like emo kids, and like it was like razor blade belt buckles, razor blade necklaces, razor blade t-shirts. It was very like Spaceballs lunchbox.
Too much. But
it was like, yeah, like razor blades on every, like it was like brass knuckles. You know what I'm saying?
I do know what you're saying, yeah, but I don't know if that was 1987.
There's razor blade. This is like inspired razor blade culture. Okay. The Rockabillys and the emos like razor blades.
All right.
It's there.
I know. That part I agree. I just kind of, the dotted line to toasters. I don't know if I see
it. It's there. It's there.
Let's play one more track. Let's play Pool Shark.
Correlation is causation.
Pool Shark. This is New York Fever version.
I thought it was fall.
I don't know why this version is playing.
It's the version we had.
Yeah. Let's listen to it anyway. How did that happen?
Yeah, you did it.
I fucked up. As soon as it came on, I'm like, wait a second, this isn't the right one.
Nah.
Hey, you know what was a good album? New York Fever.
Yeah,
I'm not going to be talking about it at all.
His vocals sound better on this, actually.
Well, yeah, it's like three albums later. Yeah. 92.
I was like, this isn't the one. I mean, they're different. The other one's
a little this doesn't, you don't... You don't hear the like crazy bass playing.
His vocals are so much like silkier.
Anyway, Pool Shark's a good song.
I don't know if I've heard that.
Good song.
Well, while I like try to make my face a little bit less
red. And this
red,
is when, this was what inspired your what's the most ska sport?
Is pool
bowling versus pool.
This is the second time we've in 2 weeks that we played a song called Pool Shark by a ska band.
Yeah.
Also, Cherry Pop and Daddies have a song called Pool Shark.
Damn,
the
cherry flopping saddies.
Something was going on.
Well, these pool sharks, people are getting, these ska bands keep getting hustled by pool sharks.
Yeah. You
have to write songs about them. All right, well, let's take a break. And when we get back, let's get some more toasters going.
Yeah!
Welcome back to Checkered Past. Celine, Rob, and KMoy are here, and we're talking toasters. And the time scotching continues us further. And we are going to now talk about what Moon was doing right after the release of Ska Boom. By 1987, they had 15 plus releases, including the first Skaville USA compilation that was released to showcase other burgeoning NY-based ska groups.
Skaville USA.
Yeah. You really like that song. Like, I mean, you might pretend like you don't, but you brought it up a few times.
You like that song?
I do love that song. I've said it a few times. The release of Ska Boom would raise the Toaster's national visibility and by extension Moon's, which would cause the label to truly pick up speed by 1988. Wasting no time, the band hit the studio again for an almost immediate follow-up. Celluloid Records was so happy with the response of Ska Boom that they formed a ska-only sister label called Ska-loid. They would give Bucket the ability to put the whole album together and feature some of his favorite songs that he had recorded up to that point. It was produced by Joe Jackson. There is a CD version of this one as well that has 15 songs on it. This is the one I'm familiar with. But the album was called Thrill Me Up. It's released in 1988 and featured a stripped back lineup from 11 to 8 with less wild bass playing, piano and percussion, but retaining the horn based melodies and the rotating and varied vocals. The Unity 2 are still featured on this. The album, however, severely underperformed. Ska-loid also released Bim Scalabim's Tuba City, but almost immediately folded a year later, as did the parent label Celluloid, which we'll talk about after. But let's move on from Ska Boom to the second album, Thrill Me Up. And let's kick it off with Ska Killers, actually, because that's kind of like the anthem from the album. No, no slap bass anymore. That's gone. How do you like that? Surf?
It sounds kind of like how.
Yeah. It does.
How. Bam, bam, bam. What were you going to say, Kenny, before I interrupted you?
No, you're right. It does sound like that song. I think it was probably like influenced by that song on purpose.
Yes. ZZ Top did not send the
That's just fucking funny.
I don't know.
What, that line?
What was the line?
Yeah, just like, and I don't mean Jamaica, Queens. It's funny. Because that's a place in New York, if you're paying attention.
Just all the New York references from the most British guy you've ever seen. Yeah, that song's a ripper. I love it. So let's talk about it. Thrill Me Up.
It's good.
Thrill Me Up.
Kenny.
Thrill Me Up. Very nice album. I like this one. The sound changes a lot. It sounds a little like more shiny and a bit, you know, influenced by 80s pop production, not in like the more way that like the next album after this one would. But like when you hear this, it's got some nice songs on it. And I should say, like, another big part of the Toasters that influenced me a lot is their song structures. Because you notice like their songs are like driven by these horn lines that have these great melodies that I really love. But another thing that happens in a lot of Toaster songs is that the bridge will be a minor part. It'll be like a minor key horn section. And I totally use that for my song Since 1989. That was like the total Toasters move right there. And it's present in the first song, Go Girl, which is, you know, another one of my favorite Toaster songs. Yeah, like this album a lot. Sounds different. The bass lines start to sound cleaner, shit like that. And I think we should mention, like, how we sort of think of the Toasters as being this band that's red, that's, like, led by Bucket. But some of their, like, classic songs aren't written by him. Like, Thrill Me Up, that song was not written by Bucket. It was written by one of the Unity 2, I think. Densmore. Or maybe that's somebody else in the band.
No, that's the two of them. CC and I can't remember the other guy. Maybe I got their names wrong. But I remember reading an interview where they said they were able to write more songs on the second album. And correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't it like two or three songs before Bucket is the lead vocalist? Like, I feel like they take a lot of front and center in a lot more songs this time around, which would be a common move later when Cooley joins too, that they give Cooley a lot of songs too. But here, there you kind of see the more band-centric thought.
Yeah, yeah, that's a good point. Like, there's a part of there's a part of the Toasters where it feels like Bucket is the lead singer sometimes. Like for like half the album, he'll be like, "I'm singing lead on this song." Like especially with their later albums, with like
you know, New York Fever, Dub 56. I don't get how that process happens, but like, it's pretty cool. Like, if you listen to live version of Thrill Me Up, which I love, the live version of Thrill Me Up from Dub 56 is like a perfect study in how to write a ska bass line. Just listen to that song. It's absolutely perfect. But, you know, they got Cooley Ranks singing lead on that one, and he sounds perfect for it. And it's like, oh, Bucket, you could have done this one, but he didn't sing lead on the original, so I think that's why he doesn't do it.
Bucket, I feel like, is the band leader, but he is not the focal point of the band in a lot of ways. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Like, he leads them in the kind of a way that, like, you know, old big band jazz people, like, you know, the clarinet player would be, like, the band leader, but it's not, like, only clarinet is playing in the songs.
It's not like the guy, like the main guy, and then the other people. It's like quite the, like, it's a band. People are talking about the toasters.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
Absolutely, they know Bucket as like a kind of mythic human being, but
an ethereal ska being,
truly
ethereal.
Yeah, and like, you know, he. Well, I remember going to the toaster show, and he was the one still selling merch. Like, he sold me the Megalith albums that I bought when I was there.
That's sweet.
He's in there. He's in the weeds with everybody else, and yeah. He creates a band around him. He said that the main reason why the band changes so often is A, they play like 200 shows a year, and B, New York is just like famously difficult to hold members down because it's such a transitory city where people come and go from different parts
probably
of the
different
world.
Projects. And...
Yeah, or they're just, there's lots of opportunity there, so you're doing all kinds of different stuff. So it's hard to nail the same lineup down year over year. But yeah. Throw Me Up is one I don't listen to like front to back too often, because I'd say there's a lot of songs I love, and then a few songs that I'm just like okay on. It's not as like iconic in the way Ska Boom has got like
it was a little anticlimactic after listening through to the first one for me.
It was
not bad though. There's nothing wrong with it. It just like I was like, oh, this is as like a first time listen through all the albums. My perspective was like, oh, this is like good, but not as good.
I do feel similar to you. Like, I don't rank Thrill Me Up above Ska Boom. But yeah, I think like when I think about the album, I just think of like, I usually like think of all the parts I like, but same thing with Ska Boom. Like when I've had to like listen to Ska Boom for this podcast to like hear the whole thing again, I'm like, oh yeah, there's still like the ABCs of like Drugs and like Toast on the Coast and like Ideal Man and all these other songs that I would always skip if I wasn't trying to give like a full listen for this podcast. But yeah,
I forgot that I thought I was going to talk a lot about how much I dislike the song ABCs, and I forgot to talk about it.
Yeah.
It was like one of my least favorite toaster songs, and it's very
things that don't hold up
goofy, and it's almost like it's almost like a rap. Like, it's got this like
things that don't hold up.
Yeah, that's the Unity 2 doing like their reggae rap thing. I think this is a time actually to bring up the thing that I wanted to talk about, Rob, about the toasters and their lyrics, and how that can be a detriment to people who like want to hear the band.
Should we play Decision at Midnight first before we?
Sure.
Yeah, let's do that.
Gotta say up front, love this song. Great song.
This
love
is a great
this song.
Song. Damn. Fantastic. A toaster's classic. The way the tempos change.
Mr. Trouble. We need to
Oh, Mr. Trouble.
Yeah.
Trouble.
Like, that's the thing that I... It's nice that he has a continuity, but, you know. Mr. Trouble, that was a song in Ska Boom, for those of you paying attention. God damn! What a beautiful horn line. Shit!
How do you feel, Rob?
About what?
The song.
Oh, I love that song. But
how do you feel about the lyrics?
He's not a stellar lyricist.
No. And so this is what I want to talk about with them. And it also ties back to like the song ABCs. So what's weird about the toasters and like their lyrics is that they are living in New York City. They're living in the Lower East Side of Manhattan in the 1980s, which was like a dangerous, real place. It was a real, shady, kind of dangerous place that most people did not want to be and would be terrified to walk around at any time of day. So they were living amongst some real shit. Like, this is like, you know, an actual kind of like mythical New York dangerous neighborhood. But they still write about New York like it's a comic book that they read. Like, it's a comic book they read from, like, the 1940s. Like, Duckett's like, what's the name of a good gangster? Oh, Mr. Trouble. Yeah, there's a gangster, and his name is Mr. Trouble. And, you know, like, the whole ABCs of crack thing, it just sounds like a fucking, sounds like an after-school special. And it's like, you guys, you're not very good at, like, writing about the reality that surrounds you. The one good line I think that they have comes from East Side Beat, which is burning police cars down the street. Come on, boys, do some East Side Beat. That's awesome. Yeah. That's badass.
And I liked Oi. Oi, yeah, Oi.
What a great
name. They nailed it. They really nailed it when they wrote Oi, Oi. Yeah.
But yeah, so that's why some people would be like, oh, I don't fucking like the Toasters. Toasters is fucking lame. And like, yeah, I see it. It's not the lyrics that I come for. It's everything else around it. So, yeah.
Right.
Yeah. It's a party. There's great horns.
But it's the a fair criticism.
Oh,
if
very
somebody
fair.
Was to come and be like, well, like, yeah.
Is that your criticism? Because you're, you said that like somebody else was about to come and make that criticism.
They're not great. I think we could all, it makes it like if I was to rate it, you know, without like as much bias, it would give it like, it would knock off points. It would knock off points.
C minus.
Yeah. Yeah,
the melodies
they're not
are good.
They're
catchy.
Not like horribly offensive.
No, yeah.
Like even what like I for a minute sometimes I'd be like, is this offensive? Because I'm like, why are you talking about this? And I'm like, oh, it just didn't go anywhere. Yeah. Like you're bringing up something kind of, I guess, like edgy, and I'm like, oh, that's it. I was like, okay, I guess that wasn't offensive, but like, why?
So you know what? Let's. I got one more song queued up because this one is it has a different vibe. And it's semi-political in nature, and it was written by one of the Unity 2, so let's listen to Haitian Frustration.
Are there French lyrics in this song?
I believe. And there's one drop up front. Yeah. That's the drum beat that would famously be used in Here in Your Bedroom.
Yeah. Actually, that's called the Steppers beat. Because
is it a two-steppers? Okay. I think that one goes up on
1, 2, 3, 4 with the kick. If you listen to it, pulsating every quarter note. So it's called Steppers. Yeah.
Yo, baby dog, what's up with that? Won't you please tell me what you gonna do next? From what I understand, you don't stand a chance. Obey, why don't you check with funds? Yes, big fat boy, one thing you must understand. Haitian land is no longer in your hand.
Almost like in a dub vibe.
Pseudo-dub. You became a teen, you met Edie, I mean. Now I understand why you're such a violent fiend. Going around calling yourself a
song.
I tell you why you're just a dictator.
Yeah, but like this bass line, this bass playing is a lot more in line with like how I identify like the third wave ska reggae sound. It's a lot closer than like what was going on in ska.
It's way more restrained, and I am grateful for the lack of bongos.
Yeah. We don't need bongos on every song.
I didn't miss them. Yeah, it was as much as I love Ska Boom. Like I feel like I was critical of Ska Boom. It's one of my favorite Toasters records.
It doesn't sound like it.
All I am talking about is how unfunky they are, how there's too much
bongo.
You
hate bongos.
But yeah, that's throwing me up. So let's move on to the next little bit. I want to talk about Celluloid Records a little. Is anybody familiar with this label?
No.
Not really.
So this is actually a semi-big indie label in the 80s. It was founded by a French dude named Jean Caraco, who wanted to release No Wave records. So he was like a big proponent of No Wave in the late 70s and early 80s. He became famous for founding Bill Laswell, the record producer, who basically was a champion of lots of pre-Run DMC hip hop. So like Africa Bambaataa and all those kind of cats. He got a lot of their first records out, including that song, that Africa Bambaataa Johnny Rotten song. That was him that put that together. So in the mid 80s, celluloid, because of Bill Laswell, became kind of like a big deal, and they were able to kind of really expand nationally. And then, but Bill became so popular with pop music that he no longer had time to spend with them. So they grew because of him, but then he left. So that John Carrico guy just started basically releasing as much weird music as he could find. He was especially really fond of ska and Brazilian music. And so he spent a ton of time and money on all of that. And obviously Ska Boom paid off pretty decently, but Throw Me Up did not. It lost them a whole bunch of money, but he took a lot of bets on a lot of different kinds of music, especially all the Brazilian music he liked. But he got lucky, and one of the comps that he had put together of Brazilian music got huge in France, where he's from. And so big enough that he decided he was going to jump ship, and he left New York, and he sold celluloid records for a dollar. And the guy who picked it up found out that he was basically totally in debt, and then bankrupted the company a year later. So
damn.
Throw Me Up. Yeah. So it was like one of the last releases, and one of the real, like, what do you want to call it?
Nails in the coffin
for celluloid records.
You were putting a nail in the coffin.
It's like, what's that thing that you do?
Yeah. I was like,
Stake in the Vampire. It was a real Stake in the Vampire for celluloid records. Those for you, Joey. But the opposite was happening with Moon Ska, because in 1988 to 1990, Moon released records by New York Citizens, Dancehall Crashers, The Busters, and the Ska Face compilation that featured The Toasters, Bim Scala Bim, The Ska Flaws, Let's Go Bowling, and No Doubt. So with no home for their releases anymore, The Toasters took it upon themselves to release all their future albums by themselves and released their 1990 third album, This Gun for Hire. It featured another lineup change with Bucket at the helm and had a much more relaxed, less aggressive sound, with Bucket taking over the producer chair. While not very well regarded, it acts as a very important turning point between their late 80s and early 90s sound. So let's talk about the last album on the docket, This Gun for Hire. I only have two tracks queued up, so let's start with
Havana. Half of my heart is in Havana Unana.
I remember that song.
Yeah, I remember that one too.
It was a cover of this song.
Could you imagine?
Camila Cabello. I never know if it's Camila Cabello, Camila Cabello.
Camila Cabello.
Camila Cabello.
Now I'm
the exact fuck no.
A man in Havana packs a big cigar.
Hashtag vibe.
One step outside.
What do you mean they're not
that sexual? Come on.
Very like Bond.
Yeah.
James Bond.
They have an adherence to the spy ska.
Yeah, type spy ska.
They love it.
That's true. That's something that we didn't even talk about. Like their song Matt Davis, Special Agent. That was, I think that was Bucket being like, I want to do a James Bond song without entirely ripping off the riff.
Yeah, I want to basically do that, the Selector James Bond cover, but totally.
Secret Agent Man.
They do a cover of Secret Agent
They
do. on a future album, yeah.
They love it.
They love it. They
this
love
was their
shit.
Secret Agent Man.
Yeah.
So yeah, this album is weird to me. It's damn. I listened to this again a couple of days ago. Like, I've only listened to this album in full in my life maybe like 3 or 4 times. I always kind of end up giving up because there's something about it where it just feels like it doesn't have that many good songs, and the production feels too plastic. And sometimes I'm like, oh, I'm going to listen to this album and listen to the bass lines, because that's when, you know, Matt Malls joins and I love him. He's my, like, my favorite ska bassist probably. But even that doesn't save this, especially because the bass isn't mixed that high. I feel like the one song I do enjoy off of this album is the first one, Worry. But yeah, bucking in the producer's chair, not really a great idea. Even like the ska guitars kind of sound, they don't sound that good. I think Beth would know what's going on. There's something where like the compression, the attack is like, I don't know. It feels like thin and snappy at the same time.
Super tinny.
It's weird.
I also found that this album lacked what really makes a good Toasters album, which is like urgency. Like it has to feel like fit to explode, because like that high energy that goes from track one till track even 20, it doesn't matter how long it is, but you really need some energy in there. And this felt a little like there was a little relaxed, and maybe it was just because they were trying to like trying something new, first time they were producing everything and doing it all themselves. And you know, I mean, I think the Toasters really are beholden to their lineup at any given time. You have some notes.
I just had a thought. Ahead. Remember when we used to go by song? This would have been like so long to get through song by song.
Oh, if we ever did the song by song thing? Now this album would have been fast. This was 10.
It is only 10 tracks.
Oh, but it was only 10.
The last two
felt long.
This one felt so long. I think it took a couple listens.
It was only 10, eh? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Interesting.
Speaking of lineups being beholden to their lineup, like, I mean, this is skipping ahead, but do you know how much they changed from this album to New York Fever? Because they have the singer from New York Fever on this one. They have the bassist from New York Fever, too. And New York Fever is kind of like, that's probably number one or number two when it comes to Toasters albums. So, like, and how much did they change from this one to the next?
It's a good question. I did not do my research that far, but you'd be wonder. It's actually hard to find their lineups because even Discogs doesn't have them. And I don't own these two records vinyl or CD. So I'm trying to, like...
I do have this on CD, but it's in my parents' house. I could have looked, but yeah, I forgot to do it. I was just home yesterday.
It's not your job to research. Right. It's this guy's, and I did a B-plus job of it, I guess.
A-.
All right, I'll take an A-. Yeah.
I tried to find some nice things to enjoy about it. Just tried to find some nice things to like, but it's like, oh... Again, this is an album where I can try to enjoy individual things like, oh, that's a nice voicing with the horns, but like, it's more like, are the songs themselves any good if you strip away even the ska parts of it? And I'm like, ah, no, maybe I like one song, but that's about it.
It's funny because we have the lens of the past to look through, but if you were a Toasters fan at this time, you would think like, well, I don't know, if it was me, like they started so strong and then got like their subsequent releases just didn't capture the same kind of energy of like their debut. And you're like, okay, they're still good, but they're not quite giving me what I want. And then it would be in 92 that it's like a incredible jump upward. Like,
yeah,
between this and New York Fever, like, and then there's just hit after hit, right? So it's New York Fever and I Dub 56, Hard Band for Dead. Like those three albums are back to back to back. And they're like, three, in my opinion, they're three best.
Me too.
Yeah, for sure. Like, and any one of those records I could put on and just have the best time. And I said this too, as soon as I was done listening to the first three, I immediately went over and listened to New York Fever and Dub 56 right after, because I was like, oh yeah, those records are just such jams. I'm just so happy.
But, yeah, it's such a ripper. You know? Like, again, skipping ahead, but the way that New York Fever opens, it's like, bam, fuck yeah, just amazing first song, you know?
Well, let's close it up. We'll listen to Tea Time, the closing number, and then we'll
Tea Time.
Talk about the
Tea
Toasters.
Time.
Oh, I did that before.
I'm listening to this song now and then trying to remember. There was like this one weird song on this album that had like a drum machine and shit. Do you remember that one, Rob, or Celine?
Oh.
Some weird song with a drum machine and it was almost disco-like. It was so weird. I think it was like track whatever was before East Side Beat, which again is on this album as a live cut. So
can tell they still have the same sax players from like the first two albums, though. Sax playing hasn't changed at all. They definitely changed the horns on the next one. And know
I,
that.
I mean, they get Lester Sterling to play sax there.
Yeah.
I always like a minimalist toasters, like minimalist vocal toaster song. I feel like that's where they shine because their lyrics are effective. That if they just say some things sometimes, like the same thing over and over, like that's what they shine.
Marble Man.
Yeah. Totally. Like, yeah. Those are my
big
favorite.
Big classic. Love that one.
Those are my favorite toaster songs. When it's
you know what
like
sucks about
one
this
one sippy couple of words.
What sucks about this album is that it sucks so much that Rob and I are already talking about the next albums.
Yeah.
Like, we're already like, yeah, remember Marble Man? Remember that one?
Yeah. Yeah.
Also, in your honor, I listened to the chat mix of Dub 56 because you had to, right?
Oh,
you
yeah.
just have to.
Fucking great. Fucking cool. Great.
Cooley just quit spitting fire for a solid 3 minutes. And we're going to end the podcast with just a few question the answers. We actually got quite a bit, and I'll pick out the ones that I think are funny. And you said you're going to mute our Discord, which I actually take offense to.
Well, I didn't want to see it. I didn't want to see the questions that I'd have to answer.
Robert Bull asks, is an air fryer toaster oven an actual air fryer?
I don't know. Cat bite knowledge. Chris Perez, he has an air fryer. That was the first time I've ever experienced one in my life. He's like, you want me to air fry this freaking, what, this freaking vegan burger or some shit? And I was like, yeah, do what you want. I don't even know what that is. So I can't answer that question. I know nothing about these things.
Yeah. I don't know if I
want
to
know
either.
The air fryer. I'm curious.
We have an air fryer, but
do you like it?
We only fry fries.
Apparently, it's a nice invention. It degreasifies your food items, which is good.
It sounds like a bad
it's actually,
thing.
It's a good way to reheat Popeyes if you want to go down that road.
I actually thought it was going to be fucking gross. I thought that an air fryer was like some gross thing that like levitates your food and fries it, and it makes it even grosser. And it's like, this is going to make it even more sticky and wet and weird. And like, that's what normal people like to eat. Fucking normal people love sticky, weird stuff. This is just me being autistic and like hating food. So yeah.
That's fair. Anyway. I hate a lot of food as well.
There are a lot of food questions on here. A shocking amount, actually.
Fuck! Like, anyway, let's keep going.
What's the difference between a damn deli and a regular run-of-the-mill deli? That was from this guy. Topped with, what's your favorite toppings on a damn sandwich? And also, wait, there's more food ones. What's your favorite local dish on tour? And what's your preferred pizza place? Those are the four food-based questions. Yeah. Oh, wait. There's a fifth one.
Oh, my God.
Do you prefer toast dry with butter or with jam?
Jesus Christ. Okay. So here we go. I'll try to answer all those. Difference between a run-of-the-mill deli and a damn deli is one that I go to. Once I'm inside of it, that shit is a damn deli. So there's that. Let's see. What was the other one was about? Oh, what do I like toppings on my food items? My favorite topping of all time is something you get from the damn pizza store, which is a crushed red pepper. I just shove that on everything. Love it. Crushed red pepper. I'm calling that a topping. Let's see. What else? What's my favorite pizza place? I don't know. I don't really go to pizza places all that much, but on the road is the most I've ever eaten pizza like in my life in like the last 12 years because I don't really eat pizza, but sometimes it's the one thing you can eat. So I always eat what Chris eats from Catbite. He's the vegan in the group, and I'm not like an actual practicing vegan, but meat is weird to me, and I don't even like dairy either. I like fake dairy, and I like fake meat. It's more fun, so I'm like, I'm going to eat what he's eating because I'll like it better. So yeah, I like the veganized pizza.
I like vegan food.
Toast. Toast definitely dry. I don't like jam. Not at all. Nope. I ate like an avocado thingy. Eating on the road was like the most difficult thing in my freaking life. We were in Wisconsin, and I had to like. They were like, "No, we don't got eggs," and I was like, "Damn!" And I was like, "Fine, I'll eat this weird hummus carrot." Greasy avocado weird thing with weird chickpea stuff. I'll do it. Fine. And I ate it and I was like, you know what? B+. That was tolerable. That was pretty good. Okay. And everyone was really proud of me and then they gave me a trophy. And so thanks. Thank you for the trophy. I'm kidding. They didn't give me a trophy, but they gave me a trophy with their eyes and their smiles.
Hear the chort, have a trophy.
Exactly.
That was the same episode
more Home Star
earlier. From literally here's the same.
By the way, oh, speaking of Home Star Runner, here's the thing that I do all the time. I work out in my home, right? And so like anytime I'm about to work out, just so like I know it's been an hour, I always text Beth, Tape Girl, here I go again on my own, which I know is that's a strong bad thing, but it's also like an 80s metal song. But I'm referencing Homestar when I do that, just so I could be like, okay, I started at 157, gotta end at like 3. Okay. Yeah.
I also say, I said consummate V's, consummate.
Yeah. I say pretty much anytime I say, here I go, I to myself quietly say, here I go again on my own.
What do you mean quietly to yourself? You
well, someday if it's just Celine, I'll say it out loud, but if it's anywhere else, I'll say it to myself.
Over and over and over and over.
And, okay, wait. This is actually an important question, and this is a New York question.
No and I need shade the answer, to the other question,
but this one's very important, is what I'm saying. So, our friend from Aaron, he asks, "What's the difference between a bodega and a convenience store? Mm. And is it just the cat?"
Oh, let's see. Bodega is like bodega. It turns out is like a controversial word. I see. Like, because my TikTok algorithm knows that I'm from New York, I, like, see all these TikToks sometimes of, like, some guy being like, hey, no native New Yorker ever says bodega. That is some shit that the fucking transplants say. We say the corner store or we're going to the deli, you know? And, like, I'm like, yeah. So it pretty much, what's the difference is that, I guess, I don't know, shit. It's open all the time. There's no... I don't know. What the fuck is a convenience store? So I know now. So like people in other states, they like got convenience stores, and New York is the only one that has like real delis. This is something that I had to contend with on the road and realize that I could not survive my usual way, which is if you're in New York, no matter where the fuck you are not going to walk a whole block without finding a damn deli. Like no matter where the fuck you are, you'll find a way to survive at the damn deli, get you some damn almonds, whatever the fuck you need. And so the difference between that and a convenience store is a convenience store is hella inconvenient because there's not enough of them. There you go. And they're not open 24 hours and they don't got all the good shit. That's the difference.
That's fair. That makes sense. Because like we have, there are a few convenience stores here that are like, I would say they're more likely to be family run and they're not chain stores. But if they're open 24 hours, they got like everything in there. Like anything you could possibly imagine is in there. But in Edmonton, they're tricky to get to. They're not.
I will say, there was
the ones
one
that are attached
good...
to gas stations are always open.
Oh, yeah. That's obviously. Like that's like my changed. Replacement. Yeah. Yeah. My replacement deli on the road really is the gas stations. We stop at the gas stations and I get me, you know, like some nuts, some protein bars. There was a really nice 7-Eleven actually in like one of the places we were in Texas. They had some super rare thing and like, ooh, I normally only see this shit in New York. And hey, it's $3 cheaper. Yay, Texas. So like, shout outs to the 7-Eleven in Austin, I think it was. Yeah.
Nice. The last question on here is from my lovely wife who asks something, something Missoula, Montana.
Missoula, Montana. Let's never forget what the fuck happened. Okay. We don't talk about it. We don't talk about Missoula, Montana. But, yeah. So wait, let me explain Missoula, Montana.
I like the mysteriousness of it, but yes, go ahead.
Missoula, Montana is a college town that Catbite stayed in Montana after we drove away from Seattle. It was like, it would have been like a 12 or 13 hour drive to get to Great Falls where the first gig was. So we stopped for the night in Missoula, Montana. And I thought this town has such a fucking ridiculous name. And I kept thinking, oh, I wish it was Missoula, Missouri, like we were in Missouri. It was Missoula, Missouri. And so I just started like slurring my words together. And then me and Boz, who like does merch for Catbite, just started like to say Missoula, Montana. And like this kind of, you know, Corleone kind of voice, gangster voice, and just like talk about Missoula, Montana. And then it's like an in-joke with us now. And it's like, hey, today's been a real bad day. No, even a fucking chicken could catch some flack just looking at me. I don't care where the fuck you're from. If it be the Bronx,
from Brooklyn or Missoula, Montana. You know? So that's how we talk about Missoula, Montana now, which it turns out is a town that some people actually know. Like, apparently David Lynch is from there, and Amy Interrupter is from there, and some big YouTuber is from there too. And I'm like, oh, Hank Green. I'm like, I thought nobody in the fucking world ever heard of fucking Missoula, Montana. It just sounds like a nowhere city, but the people are from there.
I thought it just sounded like a soprano. Like a name. Missoula, like, I thought the name was Missoula, Montana.
That was a person.
That's like, yeah, that's how I thought. I did, yeah, yeah, that's how I always
I thought
it
was French's brother.
Like, that's why I thought it was all like the fingers. Yeah.
Rap.
Yeah. French Montana.
Yeah. Rap music.
Now that I've killed everybody's mood, KMoy, thanks so much for joining us. This is your time to plug stuff. Go ahead and plug.
Okay, I'm going to plug Beth Has Secrets. That's a song that I did. That's a single that I did for her birthday. Her birthday's on January 1st. So, like, I don't know. I made it a tradition to, like, make a song for her. I've only done it twice. I don't know if I'll ever be able to keep it up. But anyway, so, like, that song was cool, and I produced it, and I put it out, but it was a really fast mix job. So then Beth did another mix of it, and she was like, that was cool. And then months later, she was like, I want to do another mix. I'm like, fucking fine. Okay, whatever. So listen to that song. That's one of my favorite songs that I've done, and it's like probably the only happy song I've ever done, because, like, you listen to the Precure album, that shit is weird and depressing. This is just a nice, happy song. It's like a minute and 45 seconds. Good song. I like it.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much for joining us. And yeah, that's it for Checkered Pass. So hit us up on Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, and TikTok at Checkered Pass Pod. Send us an email at checkeredpasspod@gmail.com. Support the pod and get bonus content, including a full length and unedited video of this episode. Sign up for our Checkerhead Patreon at patreon.com/ Checkered Pass.
Wait, hold on. Fuck, I fucked up. No. I have a thing that I should promote. Fuck.
Okay.
I fucked up. I want to say this too. This is a future promotion. Who knows when the fuck this album's going to come out, but me and Tape Girl are working with Peach Rings to make her first LP, and Peach Rings is one of my favorite singers and songwriters. I absolutely love her her first EP, which was called Home Alone 6, and the songs, Dream Girl and Heart-Shaped Craters are like eternal classics in my heart, and I love those songs. So I'm like super excited that we finally get to make an album with her, and that's going to be amazing whenever the fuck that shit drops. So I don't know, think about that, keep that in your mind. Who knows when that shit's gonna happen? Maybe
exciting.
Like a year from now, but it's great. That's all I wanted to say.
Hair.
That
they have very good hair.
Yes. Her hair is, and it's very great. Everybody on TikTok's like, hey, when do we drop the hair tutorial? And then she did it. You know, she's like, I don't know, my hair's just that good. I don't really do that much to prepare it.
The tutorial of a lifetime.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I got to finish this. Okay, wait. We also have merch available at checkeredpass.ca. Checkered Pass is edited by Ariane and engineered by Joey. And until next time, I'm Rob.
I'm Celine.
And in the immortal words of the Toasters, talk to me about unity. That only works when the beers are free.
Yeah!